Well, y'all, I am back again for part two of my video about my first abusive relationship, first real abusive relationship with my son's father. If you guys watched part one, I actually got interrupted by my mother now. He seems to always interrupt my videos when I make them. I've made several and never posted them, but I did finally get to post one. I finally got up the nerve to post one. So, but anyway, if you want to finish out and hear the end of that story, please stay tuned and like, share, subscribe, wherever the buttons may be. I am new to this, so I don't really know yet. So anyway, I believe we were on the part where I was about to get into what transpired and caused the demise of that relationship. So, the night that things went, as you know, just really out the window. Actually, I won't do that one yet. I do have one story I do need to tell. So, there was one particular night that I actually was sitting in the house and he returned from wherever he goes or whatever he was doing out there in them streets. And he actually, he comes in. I'm sitting on the couch and I'm watching TV. It's dark in my house because it's nobody in there but me and my baby at the time. And he was actually sleeping. So, because it was really late, it had to be around about 1:30, 2 o'clock, well, close to 2 or something like that. So anyway, I'm sitting there on the couch watching TV. He comes in. He doesn't say anything. He doesn't speak. He doesn't say anything to me. He just comes in, kind of looks at me, and goes into the bedroom. And he goes into the bedroom, and when he comes out of the bedroom, he's got this towel, and it's like a white towel, I remember, and he's holding this towel, and I remember thinking, what the heck is he doing with this towel? And I look at him, and he looks at me, he still doesn't say anything to me, and then all of a sudden, he starts hitting me with this towel. Now, when he starts hitting me with this towel, I'm like, what the heck is going on here? Because it's like hurting, like stinging really bad. And he just is just smacking me with this towel, like on my legs and stuff like that. And like on my arms and stuff. And I'm like, what the heck is wrong with you? What are you doing? And he's still doesn't say anything. He's just smacking me with this towel. Well, by this time, I'm like, I've gotten up off the couch. And I'm like, you know, we're kind of like, I didn't hit him or anything like that. I was just like, kind of in shock a little bit, like, what the heck is going on? Because I don't know why I would be shocked about anything that he did to me at that point in time. I guess I should have been used to the foolishness by then. But I still, you know, there would be days that he would do stuff and I'd just be like in awe, like, what the hell is wrong with this man? So, as I get up off of the couch or whatever and to get away from him, and then he had stopped hitting me, and I'm just like yelling, like, you know, we're like kind of, I'm like, what the hell is wrong with you? And I had on my gown, and I don't wear underwear to bed. So I had on my gown, but I didn't have any underclothes on. And I just slipped on my pants and a shirt on top of my gown or whatever. Now, come to find out, this man had, the reason it was hurting so was because he had taken a wire hanger and wrapped this wire hanger in this towel and brung it out and, you know, and started his foolishness. Now, why he would do that, I have absolutely no idea. I mean, like I said, I hadn't been anywhere. I hadn't done anything. Hadn't even said anything to him. And as I stated in the first video that I had released, that I posted, by this time, I really was, like, petty in things that I did or didn't do. Specifically because, you know, you can put up with just so much bullcrap. So I would never cook for him. I actually, because I knew he would be out in the streets all the time, when he would come home, it would look like I hadn't been in the kitchen at all, whatsoever. Because I would make dinner for myself. My son was not eating table food, so to speak, yet. He was, but he wasn't. He was still eating, you know, like baby food and stuff. So I would fix me something, but I would cook for myself, and then I would put the food away, or I would just cook enough. Just enough for me, and I would actually clean the dishes and everything before he would come in, because I just felt like, you know, you're being really disrespectful, first of all, in my house where I pay the bills and I'm the person that's purchasing the food and everything, and you're in here abusing me for nothing. And it's just like really ridiculous, you know, the stuff that he was putting me through. So this particular night, anyway, to keep going, he had decided to pull this crap with this hanger inside of this towel. And so, after I put my gown on, I mean, I put my clothes on over my gown, I walked out of the house. I left the house and I left walking. Now, I don't know what I was thinking or whatever, but when I left my son in the house with him. Now, I knew he wasn't gonna do nothing to my kid or whatever. At least I wouldn't think that he would, you know. But I ended up walking around the corner onto the street named Porter. And my friend, it was a couple of guys' friends that I had grew up with, that I'd known since probably junior high. High school, and they were actually sitting on the porch. It's like 2 o'clock in the morning. And they're sitting on the porch and they see me walking. And they're like, gee, what in the heck is you doing out here walking this time of the night by yourself? Now, mind you, it's nobody on the street because it's like 2 o'clock in the morning. So I ended up telling them what had happened and what he had did. And one of the guys that had liked me since we were in school or whatever, he was like, I'm finna go over there. We finna go over there. And I'm gonna throw his ass off of the throw him over that balcony, down them stairs. And I was like, nah, don't do that. Just leave it alone, which is always what I say when people try to interject on into get into like altercations with whomever I'm with or whatever. So I said, no, don't do that. Just leave it alone, it'll be okay. So I sit out there with them. I don't know how long I was out there with them, but we were out there like talking and chopping it up or whatever for a while. And then I think it was probably like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. I decided I'm gonna go home. So then I went back home. When I got home and I tried to get in, because I didn't have my key. Actually, I had took the keys with me, so he couldn't lock me out. And he had put a knife in the door to try to keep me from getting in. So I kept kicking the door until I got in. So this is just the kind of hell that I live with. I didn't have to be doing anything or saying anything or nothing. Just he would just come in acting ugly and acting a fool for no reason. So the camel that broke the straw that broke the camel's back, as they say. One night, we had broken up. So what had happened was his uncle had passed away, and his uncle they were taking his body to Mississippi to bury him. And so he was going to Mississippi for the funeral. And he asked me, he said, well, should I come back? And I said, if you're coming back to be with me, then no. Don't come back. And he was like, all right then. So he packed up his little belongings and he left. Now he was gone for, a few days he was gone, and maybe a week or so, I don't know, not really sure. But he was gone for a while, and I had started, now mind you, I was young, but the guy downstairs was a guy that lived downstairs, and he had started, I guess, liking me or whatever, had been liking me from the get or whatever, I don't know, but he had started trying to talk to me or whatever. So we were kind of talking, not really dating or whatever, just kind of, talking or whatever. And so he had invited me to go out to dinner. And he said, he was like, well, you know, you want to go to the movie, go out to dinner and go to a movie or whatever. And I was like, sure, you know, I don't have no problem with it. So we were going to go to the movies, and I was actually getting dressed, getting ready to go out when there's a knock on the door. And I go to the door, and it's him standing at the door. And I'm like, oh my God, what are you doing here? And he's like, I just came to see my boy, blah, blah, blah. So I'm like, all right, whatever. So I didn't see like no bags or nothing. He didn't have no bags in his hands or nothing like that. So I was like, all right, fine. I was like, just come in and watch. You can watch him while I take my bath. While I take a bath. So he's like, all right. So he's out there with the boy, with my son, and I go into the bathroom, and as I'm in the bathroom, trying to get ready, I had gotten out of the bathtub, and I was trying to get my clothes on, and he comes to the door, and he's like banging on the door, like he tries the door, and he can't get in because I have the door locked. And then he's like banging on the door, and he's like, open this damn door. And I'm like, no, I'm not opening nothing. I'm getting dressed. And he's like, I done seen your ass naked before. Open this door. And I'm like, no, you won't see me naked no more. I'm not opening anything. So he gets mad. He's like trying to bust open the door. And at that point, his cousin comes over, and he's like, I hear somebody knock on my door, and it's his cousin, and I hear him open the door. He's like, come on, dude, you know, we got to make this run, blah, blah, blah. Let's make this move. And he's like steady, you know, trying to acting a fool or whatever. So then he says something like, what did he say? Like, I'll be back or something, and you better be here when I get back, like that. So I'm like thinking to myself, I am not going to be here when you get back here. I'm out of here. So when he left, I hurried up and put my clothes on, and then I go and I tell dude downstairs, you know, I'm ready to go, whatever. So we leave, we drop off my son at my mom's house for my mom to babysit, and we went to Ponderosa. And for those that don't know what Ponderosa was, it was this restaurant where you had like this salad bar type thing, and like this really big salad bar, and then you could order like steaks and stuff like that. So anyway, we go to Ponderosa. As we're at Ponderosa, he tells me that he lost $20 or something, and so he didn't have enough money for us to go to the movies. Now my thought process was, if this date was contingent on you on a $20 bill, you shouldn't have been trying to ask nobody to go out. But that's just me. So he's like, so yeah, I don't have enough to take you to the movies, da 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 da. I'm like, all right, whatever, dude. So I'm kind of pissed off because I'm not ready to, you know, call. I'm not ready to go home because I'm out, and I really don't never get to go nowhere much. So, especially without my son. So I'm like, whatever. Take me to go get my son. So when we go get my son, he's like, well, you know, if you want to, I can wash the baby for you, and you can go hang out with your friends or whatever, da 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 da. So now that is something that I would not dare do in these day and ages, but you know, I was young and it was 1990. And so, you know, anyway, we go get him and I have him to drop me off at my friend Frida's house. So when I get to Frida's house, you know, we over there, we drinking and smoking and stuff and getting messed up. So it's getting kind of late and I tell her, I said, well, I guess I better go, you know, I need to go on to go home. But I was like, I'm hungry. I'm gonna walk to the store and get me something to eat before I go home. So I don't have to try to cook nothing. And so I left there and she was like, call me when you get home. And I was like, all right. So when I get to the store, I bought one of those Cherbro burgers that you put in the microwave, and some Doritos, I believe it was Doritos, or Pringles, one or the other, I can't remember, but it was some chips. And I had, when I got home, dude was like, I heard somebody walking up there, upstairs, and I was like, it ain't nobody but his dumb ass up there, you know. So, but because he used to break into my house and I could never figure out how he was getting in there. I had all my windows like nailed shut and I was like, this fool's still getting in here. And I couldn't figure out how he was getting in there. So I actually ended up figuring it out later, how he was getting in. So, anyways, when I get into the house, there's nobody there. So, I'm like, oh, he ain't even up here. Good. So, I call my friend, and I told my friend that I had made it home and everything. And she was like, okay, good. And I was like, girl, shoot, I thought that fool was up in here. He ain't even up in here, you know. And I was like, well, I'm going to talk to you tomorrow. I'm finna eat and then go to sleep. So I get off the phone with her. When I get off the phone with her, I go in the living room and I sat down because I had put the baby down, put the baby in the bed. And I go in the living room and I sat down on the couch and I started eating my food. I had warmed up my burger and everything. So anyway, I had sat down and started eating. And I think I had took like maybe one bite of my food. And I actually saw something out the corner of my eye. And I was like, what the heck was that? And I looked and it was him. So he's like standing there staring at me. Now, mind you, I'm drunk and I'm high. And I'm like, what the hell are you doing in my house? He doesn't say a word. He never says nothing. He just looking at me and he's looking like, he looking like me, like he ready to just kill me. So me being Billy Badass, it's like I be trying to be sometimes. I was like, what is you doing? Look, why is you staring at me? Stop looking at me like that. Standing over there looking like Shaka Zulu. Which he did look like Shaka Zulu because he ugly like that. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. So, when I said that, as soon as I said that, he like slapped. I don't know where he hit me. But all I know is my food went flying. And so the burger gone, the burger flies, the chips fly. And he jumps on me. And I'm sitting on the couch and he jumps down on me. And he's just choking me. And he choking the out of me. And I'm like, I can't scream or nothing, but I'm trying to fight him and I'm trying to hit him like this, but I can't really get a good connection with him because I'm losing my breath. Like, I literally was like, this man finna kill me tonight. So he actually ends up, my son started crying. Or I think that's what it was. I don't know what happened. He just let me go. I can't remember. But he let me go. And when he let me go, I jumped up. And we start fighting. And when we started fighting, because I had got to the point where, like, anytime he put his hands on me or whatever, I would fight him. Like, literally, we'd be in there tearing up the house. I would fight him like I'm like a nigga on the street, just fighting. So we fighting, and he, at one point, he body slammed me. Like, he, like, kind of picked me up, not picked me up all the way off the ground, because I, like I said, I've always been a big girl. So, but he didn't really, like, pick me up and just go poof, but he kind of jostled me and then threw me down to the floor. And at that point, back then I had a perm. So when I hit the floor, my hair kind of fluffed up. I ain't had real long hair, but it just kind of fluffed up enough to, you know, because I had a perm in it. And I landed on my back on the ground, on the floor, and he stood on top of my hair. He stepped on my hair. And we stepped on my hair, and he was, like, looking at me, and I don't know I can't remember if he was saying anything or whatever, but I was screaming, like, get off of me, woo, woo. So, he finally gets off of me, and then, we're, like, going around in circles, and he just doing all kinds of stuff. He's steady hitting me and stuff. So at one point, I'm like, my son started crying. Was it when I actually had sat down in a chair before my son started crying. So then he like said something. And no, I take that back. I'm sorry. I'm messing up the story. But anyway, my son had started crying, and I had picked him up out of the bassinet, and I had my son in my arms, and he was saying, give me my son. And at this point, I'm like afraid that he is going to try to steal my child. And the reason that I had thought this, or that this came to my mind that he would do that, is because he had told me before that he had tried to kidnap his daughter from her mom. So I was like, no, I'm not giving you my kid, get away from here. And I was telling him, and I was like, you know, he ain't even yours. And he said, and I sat down on the chair, and I was rocking my son, because my son was screaming, and I was rocking him, trying to get him to be quiet. And I was saying, he's not even yours. Dang it, I could have gave her this. But he was like, he is mine. He looked just like me. He ain't just like me. And I was like, no, he's not. But he is his. I just said that because I wanted him to just go away. But that was stupid. But anyway, that's what I said. So he actually grabbed my hair and pulled me up out of the chair by my hair. And when he pulled me up by my hair, I still had my son in my arms. And at that point, he started, he was like dragging me around the room by my hair. So I got my son in one arm, and I'm trying to fight him off with the other hand. And he's dragging me around this room. So I had this black folded metal chair in the living room. And he actually was like taking me around in circles, around and around in circles in this living room. And he took me past that chair one too many times. And when I went back past that chair and I snatched the chair up. And when I snatched the chair up, as soon as I did this to pick the chair folded up. So I just took the chair and just did this and hit him on upside his head. And his eye, like right here, is split, like just cut his eye right there. So he snatched the chair out my hand and he was like, he snatched the chair and threw it down. He said, "Oh, so you trying to hurt me? You trying to hurt me?" And at this point, he takes his fist and he punches me in my eye. Now, when he punched me in my eye, when I say instant, I closed up. Instantly closed up. I just could see stars. And I'm just like, oh my God, you know. This dude is crazy. Now, I have this mark in my eye. And if y'all can see it, it's like this little brown mark in my eye. But anyway, that little spot in my eye came from that. So after he did that, I was like, oh my God, I can't even see, because I couldn't see it out this eye. It was just like instantly shut. So at this point, I had went back, like got to the chair, and I just sat down in the chair, and I wouldn't even, he was pulling my hair and everything, and I wouldn't move. And all I know is I was just screaming at the top of my lungs. At one point during this altercation, I had actually got to the door. So that was before I went to the chair. I had got to the door and there was like these three stairs going like from my hallway to go down to where, to the door was like these three little steps. So I had ran down them little steps and opened up the door. And when I opened the door, I was screaming, and the dude from downstairs came like around, and he was about to come up, and he was like, "Yeah, Carl," whatever his name is, I ain't gonna say the name, and he was like, so he could get his ass whooped too. And at this point, he had reached behind, like over by the stove, and I don't know when he had put this knife to the stove, because I never leave knives and stuff like that on my stoves. And but there was this knife on the stove, and he reached like around the corner to the kitchen to where the stove was and snatched up this knife. And I was like, he telling dude he got a knife. So when I said that, dude turned around and left, and I'm like, this man done left me up here for this dude to kill me, right? So he like snatched me back in the house and then slammed the door and took the keys out of the door. Now the way my door was, you had to unlock the door with the key from the inside. It didn't have like a bolt lock. You had to lock it and unlock it with the key. So, and he had snatched the keys out of the door, and I ran back in the living room. And this is when I sat down in the chair. And when I sat down in the chair, and he had came back in there, and he was like pulling my hair and everything, but I wouldn't move. I just kept sitting there, and I was screaming and I was crying and whatever. So at this point, I could hear police sirens, but I didn't know at the time that they were coming for me. But I could hear the sirens, and I remember all of a sudden I hear this man like yelling at the top of his lungs, and he's like banging on the door, and he was like, police, open the door, open the door. And I'm like, I'm frantic. By this time I had lost it. I don't even know how to explain it. I was just hysterical at this point. Cause we had fought and everything, but it had never been anything like that. So at this point, I'm just like, oh my God. And I'm crying and I'm saying, he's like, open the door, open the door. And I'm so frantic and so unnerved at this point till I really kind of didn't even know what I was doing. And I just was, I was like, I had got up and I said, I didn't see the keys hanging in the door. And I was like, I can't find my keys. And the policeman is steady yelling, open this door. And I'm like, I can't find my keys. But I still got the baby in my arms. So something said, just try opening the door. And I just went down the stairs and I opened up the door. And when I opened the door, when I turned the knob, the door opens up. So he never did lock the door. I thought he had locked us in there, but he hadn't locked the door. So So then when I opened the door, there's like a line, like down the stairs, you can see like there's a line of police officers. It's like 5 police officers out there and dude at my door. And they got their guns out and everything. And they were like, dude was like, come down the stairs. Now, mind you, I don't have on any underclothes because I'm in my nightgown. My nightgown is like half see-through. Like it's got like these sheer panels on the side. I don't know what the hell I was doing, but I had to go on down the stairs and go outside with no underclothes on. So I get outside. When I get outside, I'm going like they're walking me like towards the front, and I hear it was one black police officer with them, and I hear him say, "Move." What is that? Move, nigga, and I'll blow your head off. Cause dude had came to the door, and he was like, "Move, nigga, and I'll blow your head off." And I heard the door slam. So he just slammed the door on their faces, and went back in the house. So at this point, the police was like, "You can go get it. Put her in my squad car, or whatever." So dude from downstairs was like, "She can." Come in my house. She could sit in my house. So he take me in his house or whatever. So the police comes back and he's like, "Look, he's not coming out. Do we have your permission to get in there, to get him out of there?" And I said, "I don't care what y'all do. Just get him out of my house." So he was like, "We got your permission to kick the door in. I don't care. Y'all tear the whole thing down if you want to. Just get him out of there." So he comes back and he was like, "You know what? It was easier than I thought it would be." He came out. We just called him on the phone. And he answered the phone and he came on out. And we talked him out or whatever. So they arrest him. And the police officer is like, "Are you hurt? Do you need an ambulance?" And he was like, "Your eye looks pretty bad." And I said, "Well, no." At first I was like, "No, I don't think I need an ambulance. I don't think I need to go to the hospital." He was like, "Your eye is really bad." He was like, "Are you hurt anywhere else?" I said, "Well, my ear is ringing because after he had hit me in the eye, he hit me in this ear." He like did that to my ear and I heard it pop and it was like ringing and it was like really bad. It was in pain or whatever. So he was like, "Well, we gonna get your ambulance and you can go to the hospital or whatever." So I when I got to the hospital, the doctor was like, he bruised my eardrum. So I have a little bit of hearing loss in that ear. Not deaf, but I got a little hearing loss in this ear. And this ear has never been right ever since. But anyway, I have like all types of problems with this ear. So after he went to jail, he was in jail for like 2 days, I think, two nights or whatever. And the first night that he was in jail, the first night he was in jail would have been that night. Then he was in jail the next day, my cousin and the guy that had wanted to throw him over the stairs had stayed a night at my house. And, to keep me company or whatever, because she was like, I'm not leaving you here in this house by yourself and blah, blah, blah. So my cousin and my friend had spent the night over. And so the morning after they had spent the night, he ended up coming to the house. And he knocked on the door. And when he knocked on the door, my cousin was like, somebody's at your door. So I went to the door. And it's this nigga. So when I get to the door, he's like, I brung you a table. And I was like, I don't want no dang table. And he was like, you don't want this table? No, I don't want no table. Not out of here. So he was like, can I see my son? And I'm like, dude, just go away from here and leave me alone. So, I had my cousin bring my son to the door, and I was like, you can see him while you're standing out here or whatever. So he sees his son or whatever, and he leaves. Now, mind you, he's got this table. He's walking down the street with this table. I don't know where he done got this table from. Probably stole that table from somewhere. I don't know. But so when he leaves, he just leaves walking with this table or whatever. So my sister ends up coming to my house later on, and she picks up my son because she's like, I'm going to take him home with me and give you time to just kind of rest, kind of chill by yourself. So I was like, all right, cool. She takes him home. Later on, this fool ends up back at my house. So he had came to the door. He's like, can I just talk to you? Da 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 da. And my stupid behind lets him in. So I let him in. I was like, what do you want? And he's like, I just want to talk to you. I'm sorry. Blah, 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 blah. This, that, and the other. So he's talking. And then he's asking me where my son is. And I told him that my son is gone. He's at my sister's house. And so he said something about me and him being together. And I told him that that will never be. That we are done. Like, I will never take him back. And so that kicked off the whole shebang bang. So when I said that, it just started all over again. Like, he started hitting me and started telling me, like, we gonna be together forever type stuff. And this, that, and the other. And that if I don't take him back, he gonna kill me. If we don't raise our son together, that neither one of us won't raise him, because I'm going to be dead and he going to be in prison. And I'm just like, this man done lost his ever living mind. So, at one point, like he was, we were in the hallway, and I was sitting on the stairs. We were sitting on the stairs, and he was steady talking. It's just like he was just talking and talking and talking, and just talking a whole bunch of nonsense and stuff that I didn't want to talk about, that I didn't want to hear. So he just talking and talking and talking and talking and about our future and about us being together and this, that, and the other. And so I started crying. I was crying. And mind you, he had already been punching on me and stuff and carrying on. So I just started crying, and I actually started praying. And I was saying, God, please help me. Please help me. Please help me. Get me out of this. And like I was saying, what have I done? What have I done that's so bad that I deserve to be treated like this? I don't hurt nobody, and I don't purposely ever do anything to hurt anybody. So why am I going through this? So at this point, he gets mad, and he's like, he grabs me by the back of my head, and he starts banging my head on the wall, and he's like, don't you ever pray against us. You don't pray against us. We're going to be together forever. We're going to be together forever. I'm thinking to myself, oh, no, we ain't. The next time I get out of this, if I get out of this one alive, I will not ever be bothered with you again. So at this point, we're like, it's like late, and he's like steady talking this foolishness, and he says he actually tries to rape me, and he's like on top of me, and we're fighting. He's trying to get up under my clothes and everything, and we fighting, and I'm trying to fight him off. And I get tired of fighting him, and I'm like, you know what, forget it. If you want it, go ahead, take it. If that makes you feel like a man, you go ahead and you take it. Go ahead. To know that you can do this to me, and there's nothing I can do to stop you, then you go right ahead and you take it. You can have it. And he's like, oh my God, Regina, you can F up a wet dream. I'm thinking to myself, do you not know that's what I'm trying to do? So he's like, oh, you know, acting like he mad or whatever. And he fall off, and he just laying there, and he's like, well, just lay here with me, and I won't touch you. I won't mess with you. I won't try to mess with you again. So we laying on the floor, and he's steady talking a whole bunch of nonsense and garbage I don't care to hear. And it was just like all night he was just talking and talking and talking. So at one point, I'm like, I can't lay on this floor no more, my back. So I get up, and he was like, where are you going? I'm like, I'm just laying on the couch because I can't keep laying on this floor. So he takes his hand, and he wrapped his hand in my nightgown so that every time I moved, he could feel me. And he would jump up and be like, where are you going? And I'm like, this man. So in the morning time, we had a whole nother argument because I went in the bathroom and locked the door to put my clothes on. We had another argument about him seeing me naked and all of this stuff. And his cousin came back and get him again that day. His cousin was always my savior, seemed like. But came and got him and took him with him. And then he was like, when I come back here, my son better be here. And I'm like, okay. So when he left, I knew, I was like waiting, like that morning, I just kept thinking, praying in my head. I was like, Lord, please don't let my sister come until he leaves. Because I know he can't sit still. So I know he's going to leave. And I'm like, don't let my sister come until he get out of here. So he did, he left. And when he left, I was like running around, like grabbing my kid's clothes and stuff and packing all his stuff up. And trying to get out of there. And when my sister came, I beat them. Like, I ran down the stairs and ran to the back, and before they could even get out of the car. And I was like, get back in the car, get back in the car. And she was like, what is wrong with you? I was like, just take me home. Just take me home to my mama. I am done. I can't do this no more. So I went back to my mama's house. And when I got back to my mama's house, my dad was like, you just left all your stuff. And I was like, I don't give a dang about nothing in that house. And he was like, well, he do. He'll have everything you got in there sold. So him and my uncle, we went back over, me, him, and my uncle went back over to the house. And we got all my stuff out of there and brought it to my mama's house. And then that night, he had called and he was like, where are you at? What are you doing, Virginia? What are you doing? And I was like, getting away from you. And he's like, "You don't you know you can't get away from me? You can't never get away from me. We always gonna be blah, blah, blah." And like I told you before, if we don't raise our son together, won't neither one of us raise him. And if I want you, I'll come over there and get you. And I was like, you come on over here if you want to. Cause I'm you know, I'm Billy Badass now, cause I'm at my mama's house. So I was like, I bet you won't leave walking in here if you come over here. So he never did come over there or whatever. But then he stalked me for like the longest time. It was just awful. Like, I couldn't go nowhere and not run into him. He was always everywhere. It seemed like everywhere I went, he was there. So he would, like, every time he would see me, he would be threatening me and telling me what he was gonna do to me and all this and that. And so one day, it had been like, I want to say a good year or so, and he had seen me walking across town, and it was like, I do want to say it was it New Year's? No, I don't know. But I was actually over there looking for my future baby daddy. My son that comes 2 years later, I was looking for his daddy somewhere out there in them streets. And he was like, he saw me, he's like, said something to me, like, you know, some more threatening bull crap. And I said to him, I said, you know what, I am so tired. I'm so tired of hearing that same shit all the time. So if you gonna kill me, then go right ahead. Go on ahead and do it, cause I'm tired of hearing it. So if you're going to do it, just go ahead and get it over with. And he looked at me and he said, you know what? You is crazy. And I was like, no, I'm not the crazy one here. You are. And he, after that, he never threatened me again. He stopped stalking me. Like, when he would see me places, he would always be trying to be up in my face. But he wasn't like stalking stalkerish type stuff no more. And I was like, okay, so that's all it took. I should have did that a long time ago. But that is the story of my son's father and his abusive ways. After that, I really never had too much dealings with him. But what I can say about him, even though me and him did not work, he loved his child. He did love his son. He always, if I called him and would be like, I need XYZ for our son, or I ordered this, like I used to order stuff from JCPenney catalog all the time, and I just call him and be like, I ordered some stuff and his stuff is here and I don't have the money to go get it. He would be like, all right, give me a couple hours and I'll be there. Like, he never really worked no job, but he would get out there in them streets and hustle. And whatever I said I needed, if it was some Pampers, if it whatever it was, he would go and get it. And he wouldn't ask no questions. He would just be like, all right, give me a couple hours and I'll be through there. I'll get the money. I'll get it. Don't worry about it. That's one good thing I can say about him. When I did move away, I moved to Minnesota, and when I moved away, he didn't know I was moving, but I left, and come to find out, like, after we left, like, shortly after we left, he went to prison, and he was only supposed to do a year and a day, and a year and a day turned into, like, 14 years, he did 14 years in the penitentiary and got out and then went right back. So he just, you know, he just was always in trouble, it seems like. But anyway, that is my story. And if you guys want to hear more of my life story, because I will, this is a series of story times that I will be telling about the men in my life and the things that I suffered, the abuses that I suffered with these men that I allowed into my space when I should not have. But it's a series of that. If you want to hear more, go ahead and come back. Turn the notifications on so you guys know when I post something new. Like, share, subscribe, and all of that good stuff. And I just thank you guys for taking the time out to listen to me. And I know this was long, and I do apologize for it, but I hope you guys enjoyed the story. So come back and see me again. Later.